is here. Right now. Lord, you're here. Right now. You're here.
Hello, everybody. Well, you may be seated. You know, I wanted to come and I just felt we needed to spend some time with God, you know, just to sit in his presence and listen to worship and love on him and what he has done for us. When we know Jesus marched through the city and they were praising him. And this is a time of praise for what he has done for us. I just felt led that we needed to come before God and to just worship him and love the Lord Jesus. How many of you love the Lord Jesus? That's why you came to this ministry. Isn't that right? You came because of him. You came because of Jesus. And this is one of the most high holy days in the Christian world, but it's more to me than that. It's the high holy day of the very person that gave up everything for us. And he is everything. He did everything. He has everything. He's been given everything by God. God has entrusted him with all of humanity. God has entrusted Jesus with all of heaven and earth. He's entrusted Jesus with over all men. He says the head of the man is Christ. The head of Christ is God. He said all power is given unto me in heaven and earth when he rose from the dead. So everything belongs to him, and I realize that even more this holiday, that God used to be the one mainly over man and over the creation and over the animals, but Jesus has been given all the earth. He's over attending to humanity and souls, and he's over attending to the animals and the plants on the earth. I mean, the Lord spoke that to me today, how Jesus has been given all things by his Father to be over not only on the earth, the kingdom of the earth, but also the kingdom of heaven. So he's over the angels now. God used to be over the angels, but now Jesus is over the angels. Jesus is over man. Man is over woman, but Jesus is over the whole creation. He's over animals, fish, birds, cattle, whatever animal, living or creeping thing that Jehovah made. God has put Jesus over everything because of what he did during this day that we are celebrating. You must understand the honor and the worthiness and what not of what, you know, how worthy he is, but also what he has been entrusted with. So you can know the scope and the vastness of his power, you know, beside the Father. And so I'm just so thankful, because my whole heart is to be close to Jesus, to win Jesus in a closeness, not just like nobody else have, but in every dimension that I can and that is available. And so he wanted that with Jehovah, his Father, and he got it. He sits at the right hand of God today, which is the highest seat. But even more than that, Lucifer wanted the throne, but God has offered a closeness for us with Jesus that is extraordinary. And I thought just to sit in the right-hand seat it is the highest honor, but there's an even greater honor than the right-hand seat. And Jesus said, to him that overcometh, this is in Revelation, to him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as my Father, even as I overcame, and I am now set, and he says, my Father has allowed me to sit with him in his throne. And so you got to understand what that means. Like, you become one, you walk in and out of God, you can go on God's throne and sit with him in his throne. that seat of power that Lucifer coveted and lusted after. The Lord said, to him that overcometh. So I want you to know, you need to understand my drive to be close to God. I know that you got to overcome things. You got to become an overcomer. So when you really want a person that bad, you will overcome things. That's why I overcame a lot of things, struggles. I didn't make excuses, and too many Christians make excuses. I'm not saying that we will always be overcoming while we're walking on this earth. But I just think so many Christians, they are lazy, and they will never get these things that I'm talking about. God will never let you come to these places if you don't be an overcomer. You know, the way that I have become God's friend, and then an imperial in his kingdom, and then a right-hand friend, I've occupied one of those seats in heaven already that's next to God, but it's on the side of Jesus. Jesus is the one that's right next to God, and then God has all these other right-hand seats that he himself, not Jesus, he himself chooses what man or woman will sit on there for all of life, and you only have one lifetime to gain one of those seats while you walk this earth. And there are very few of them, because it's very difficult to get it, and it's possible to get it by the time before you ever die on the earth while you live here. I got mine in 1986. I was told that I had come to that place in 1996. I was 23 years old. But I was already doing things that even adults weren't willing to do. I was willing to do whatever God wanted me to do. Are you willing to do that? And I'm just trying to tell you, you have one lifetime on earth. Let me say this to you. When you die here on the earth, when you die, because you will die one day, when you die, and if you make it to heaven, I pray that you do, say that you do. Whatever you did here on earth, your position with God will be solidified with whatever you did here to obtain whatever closeness you have. You cannot get it once you go to heaven. You cannot work for it once you go to heaven. All the testing is done here on earth. So this is why I'm telling you, you can't waste time. If you really want to be close to Jesus, you got to pay the price while you live on this sphere of life, or in this realm of life, which is on earth. Do y'all understand that? So Jesus is always telling the church all these rewards he's going to give us in heaven, but we got to be an overcomer. What is your struggle here? You got to overcome that. You got to overcome. You cannot make excuses. And so if you fall in love with Jesus, you will overcome. Because love never fails. When you really love, there is no option for failure. When you don't love someone, there is an option for failure. You opt out, or you have this backdoor trap in the back of your mind, like, I can get out of this at any time or whatever. Like, for me, there is no way out for me. Because that's how in love I am with him. There ain't no way out for me. I don't want a way out. There ain't no back trap door in the back of my mind for Christianity, and definitely not for Jesus. How many are in love with him? Wave your hands. I'm not jealous. I mean, I would like to see some of y'all, you know, sitting in one of those right hands, because I'm already way beyond the right hand. Right hand is in eternity. It's in heaven. It's in the third heaven. I'm already in the infinity dimension. So, look, I wouldn't mind seeing some of y'all there, but you got to pay the price. You cannot be playing around. Those promises. It's to him that overcometh will I do this. To him that overcometh. Then he says to one of them, to him that overcometh, will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I overcame and sat with my Father in his throne. And for me, sitting in Jesus' throne is not about the position like it was with Lucifer. It's about there is a level of closeness in it. That's what it means to me. It means it's a closeness. Instead of sitting at his right hand, I can sit in his throne with him at times. Oh, yeah, I'm getting that, P.O.P. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'm going to get that. Yeah. I'm going to get that. I'm going after it. Yeah. Everything I've went after with God, he's gave me that and more. So I want to show you some things like, you know, this love that he shared with us and toward us during this time on the cross and his death. It should make you fall so in love with him. It's not that we first loved him, but that he first loved us. It should make you fall so in love with him that love never fails at anything. That love will never fail. So sit down for just a moment. I want you to get your Bible, and I want to show you something. I want to show you these scriptures, and then we're going to start with the first song and just sit here and listen and worship him. And the first song will be the Mississippi Mass Choir. We thank you. That's the song when Jesus first appeared to me when I was 17 years old. I would sit by the radio and just listen to that for hours and hours and hours and cry and weep and thank him. We thank you for salvation. And that song, that's all that song is about. We thank you for salvation, for dying on the cross, for hanging on the cross from the 6th to the 9th hour. That's 3 hours on that cross. Nails holding him up, nails in his feet. And we're talking about the suffering even before that time, the whipping on the post. All I would do was sit there. You say, what would you do for hours, sitting there for hours crying, thinking of all of that he done for me? And I was like, just thankful and singing that song, we thank you. I thank you for salvation. And because of that, I'm going to praise you. I'm going to thank you. And I just believe that most Christians don't have a spirit of gratitude. They don't have a spirit of real thanksgiving in their heart for what Jesus did for them. You just couldn't. Most of them are adulterers against God. I'm talking about spiritual adulterers in their relationship. They want the world more than him. You want to know why they want the world more than him? It's because they ain't in love with him. They don't appreciate him. This song helps you to focus your appreciation on what he did on Mount Calvary, on Golgotha's hill. So the first thing I want to show you, turn with me to Revelation. I want to just reiterate and go over by scripture what I was just sharing with you. There is a level of closeness to Jesus that is beyond the right hand, and it means to sit with him. And that is to sit with him in his throne. And there are many things in Revelation the Lord promises that he could give us to him that overcometh. But I want to go over the one where he said, he talked about ruling the nations with a rod of iron. He talks about, I'll make you a pillar in the house of my God, or in the temple of my God. So many promises. The lukewarm church was the one he promised that to. So he says the slothful church, the slothful, the people who are slothful and who loses their fire and they're neither cold nor hot. They are lukewarm. He offers them a promise that if you overcome slothfulness, I will let you be this close to me. I'll let you sit in my throne. You gotta read what they had to overcome. They had to overcome being spiritually naked. They had to overcome being spiritually blind. They had to overcome being poor spiritually. They were poor and had nothing spiritually. And they were lukewarm, and they were not zealous. So Revelation chapter 3, verse 20 through 21, listen to what he says. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him and him with me. See that? 21, to him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame. You see, Jesus had stuff to overcome. And I'm sat down with my Father in his throne. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit of the Lord said to the churches. Of course, I've sat in the Father's throne, not like this, but in the Father's lap. Let me say that I've sat in his lap while he sat in the throne. But this is another dimension here. Jesus is saying to those who overcome, I will let you sit in my throne with me. The Bible says we sit in heavenly places in Christ. That's a position. But this is a physical location. We sit in heavenly places in Christ in the spirit. But I'm talking about once we enter heaven, this is a physical place in the third heavens. Where Jesus has his kingdom outside of God's kingdom, and he has a throne. And we can sit in his throne with him. How many of you want that? How many want that closeness? I don't know what kind of power comes with that. I don't know what is released with that. All I do know is that if I can sit with him, you hear, that's the point with me. The words that he says, sit with me in my throne. The part that's strong with me is about being with him. It ain't just being, oh, I'm going to be in his throne and I'll be able to have power like he has. The power is not my focus. Being with him is my focus. The closeness of this blessing to me is about being close to him. Do y'all see that? He says to sit with me in my throne, even as I overcame and sat with my Father in his throne. So he sits with Jehovah in his throne. To be granted that kind of blessing? Do you even know what that means? Let me show you something else. And so there's exceeding great and precious promises to us who believe, to those who really believe. And I'm going to tell you, I didn't know. The reason why I know all of these things are real is because I started experiencing them at a young age. And I didn't even know I had it. I didn't know I came into it. I thought I was too young to be God's friend. And I thought I was too young to be the emperor of the whole world. In 1986, when Christ first revealed to me I was, and then gave me the keys to his whole kingdom in 1997. I didn't understand why he would come to me and give me these things. I didn't ask for them. But I do know I would sit by the radio and listen to worship songs and just cry my eyes out because of this deep connection me and him had. And I had developed that just from sitting with him for hours, sitting with him every day and being consistent. And I'm telling you that I'm a witness that if you will surrender your life to him and your love to him and your everything to him, you'll receive everything. And I just think we make a religion out of Christianity. I think we've done a disservice to Palm Sunday and to the Lord's Day. Because we don't really fall in love with what he did. Fall in love not just with what he did, but with him for what he did. It's, the Bible says it's not that we first loved him, but that he first loved us. Turn with me to Philippians chapter 3. I'm going to show you something else. This used to be the key foundation when I first got saved of my strongest pursuit with God. And I hope this helped you and put you and set you on a path to do this. I want to show you what I learned and how the Lord took me. Philippians chapter 3, verse 7. And of course, you know, after I received the right hand seat with the Lord to sit at the right hand of God next to Jesus for all of eternity in 1986, then that little 9-year-old boy and another prophetess were taken to heaven and by Jesus, and they basically saw my seat there. I had never told anybody. I had never shared that kind of stuff with anybody. I just didn't want to get persecuted. I was already getting persecuted for what I was doing. So I definitely wasn't going to start talking about the dreams I had had, that God had told me that I was an emperor, I was an imperial, and then that I was I had a right-hand eternal position with God sitting next to Jesus. Those things that the sons of Zebedee, sons of thunder, asked him, can we one sit on your right and the left? And then Jesus said, I can't give that to you. Only my Father can do this. I'm talking about one of those seats. I had one, and I never asked for it. And as time went by, and then God began to confirm it. I would never teach on nothing like that about the right hand back then. You know, I was still too young to understand. And then other people started being taken to heaven, and Jesus showing them I had a right hand seat at the throne of God for eternity. So that's how I know the things that I receive from God, they are real because they are always confirmed. I remember when God called me a general, you know, he had given somebody a dream the same night that I was a general. Like, he always confirms what he's doing in my life spiritually because he knows I don't play around. I don't want to hear a bunch of lies. I don't want to hear a bunch of fluff. You know how you got a lot of Christians, they boast and they brag and they exaggerate, they lie. They are not that in God. They think they're something. They are not. God has to be the one to sanction you. He has to be the one to ordain and speak those things over your life. Can't be making up stuff. And that's why I'm very bold. That causes a boldness in you to for reality, spiritual realities. I call them spiritual realities. You know, it's a reality. Even though it's in the spirit, it's a spiritual reality. I think I ought to write a book called Spiritual Realities. I'm going to tell my personal testimony how I got spiritual, real stuff in the spirit that was real. Spiritual realities. How God would confirm it by even showing other people. I didn't tell nobody anything. You know what I'm saying? You know how some of these Christians, to get some prophecy, they're halfway be helping the prophet out. I don't want to help nobody out. Listen, if God has spoken if this stuff is real, God is going to say something he's going to confirm it without anybody knowing anything. I remember when I was introduced to David Paul's ministry out of Hartford, Connecticut, I think. Very powerful prophet. He's a good friend of mine. He's been in ministry many years. He was in ministry many years before, you know, when I was younger. I remember when I first went to his meeting before we ever even knew each other, he even knew my name or anything. And he called me up. I was in one of his services. He just called me up. He says, your name is David. And then he said, you have been taken to heaven many times. And you've seen the Lord. Like, see, he didn't know none of that. And, you know, a lot of these prophets that you see now calling names or doing stuff like that, this stuff has been going on for many years. I remember the prophetic movement. It's an old movement. It just looks new to the people today. So I remember him. That was the first time I had met him. We hit it off from there because when the Lord told him not only my name, but how I had been to heaven, and how close I was to him, and I had many visitations. He's no way he could know that. And my whole staff was there at the time, and they knew, like, wow, that was amazing. Because everybody else who he called their name, he didn't say they went to heaven and have stood in front of the Lord and all of that stuff. You understand? So I think I still got the tape of that meeting. But I'll never forget when he called me out. Then he called my name. He told me what my full name was. Then he told me that I had been taken to heaven a lot. And I have this special relationship with God, and I've stood before God. And there's no way he could know that. No way he could know that kind of stuff. Then he began to say, yeah, but I see you have also chafed a little bit. He says, because of leaders and pastors have mistreated you. He knew everything. Not everything, but I mean, he just knew what God told him to tell me. What I'm saying is, spiritual realities, I've had them. It ain't about just no gift to me. It's about the Lord himself. And that's what this got to be about to you. That's why you came here. I'm not just training you so you can learn the gifts, the anointings, the powers on your life, the callings, the destiny, the ministry. I really brought you here to fall in love with God. That's what my school is about, for you to fall in love with the Lord. That's the main thing. How many understand what I'm saying here? Wave your hands. Because it don't matter if you're used in very powerful ways. If your heart isn't right, if you're not full of this Jesus that I'm talking about, it's going to corrupt you. It's going to be automatic. So I am trying to get you to not just fall in love with this person. I want you to see the love he has for you. Because if I can get you to see that, you will fall in love with him. And you'll be loyal to him. And you'll be a different person. But I want to show you the scriptures he gave me that led up to these things. These spiritual realities that I talked to you about, that I've received in my life. Philippians chapter 3, verse 7. Listen to what Paul said. But what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. That's what you got to do. You got to think of all the things that matter to you. Gain means a value. What do you value in this life right now mostly? Is it your family? Is it a love or romantic relationship? What is it? Is it money? Is it success? Is it fame? What is it for you? What is gain to you? Because what may be gain to you may not be gain to somebody else. Like, money has never been my thing. That's why I always have so much of it. you know what I'm saying? I was wealthy when I was a young in my early 20s or late, middle to end 20s. And when God asked me to give up everything I own, I gave it up because money don't matter to me. But there was something else that mattered to me. And that was being in love. You see what I'm saying? So it may be one thing for you, another thing for another person. The point is, Paul said what things were gained for me, those I counted loss or nothing for Jesus. And that's what I did. But you got to come to grips and be honest about what matters to you. And until you do that, until you really come to grips with what really matters to you and stop lying about that, I don't really care about nothing. You care about something. Something matters. And it's that thing he wants. It's that trade-off that he needs in order for him to bring everything to you. God will never believe that you mean everything to him if that thing you value the most, you are not willing to give up for him. And so that was the young rich ruler's problem. He kept all the commandments. That was never his problem. I don't know how he did that, honestly, because I know I've broken a lot of those. But he said, I've kept
your commandments. From my youth up, I broke one, not one of them.
He says, there's one thing you do lack, and that's what I want. Go sell everything you have and give to the poor. He couldn't give up money. It was money for him. You got to identify what is gain to you. So I would sit down after I would have those long sessions of crying before God. I would read this and then I would be honest with myself. What do I really gain? What do I really value? What is gain to me? And I will lay those things down for him. I said, I will submit and I will give this to you right now because of what you did for me on the cross. Just because of the love you gave me for me to have eternal life, you suffered all that for me. Jesus, I'm willing to give you everything. Now watch this. First of all, he says, Paul goes straight at it. I'm going to go after the things that are really, that really matter to me and give that up for Jesus. Then the next thing he says, not only that, but everything I'm going to give it up. He didn't just say I'm going to give up the things that matter. He said, I'm going to give up everything. Listen to what he says in verse 8. Yea, doubtless. He says, without doubt, I count all things but loss. Watch this. For the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord. That is huge. I had to meditate on that for years to understand just those words. And yea, doubtless, I count all things lost, not just for the knowledge of Christ. He said, for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus. In other words, he's saying, I want what, you know what excellency is? It's the highest level of understanding and knowledge about a person. This is why Jesus gave me the keys of the kingdom, because by the time I was in 1987, I was already sitting by the radio for 6-7 years, just seeking his face, loving him, and going after the excellency. This scripture, these scriptures in Philippians, from the time that I was 17 up until the time he gave me the keys of his whole kingdom, I said, I want the highest level of everything there is about you. The excellency, not just the knowledge of Jesus, the knowledge of God. No, the excellency. Paul said, that is valuable to me, I count loss for Christ. When you start dealing with the thing that really matters to you, God has to get that in order for you to be saved. Like the young rich ruler, if you won't give that up, you can't even be saved. But then to go beyond, okay, I know I'm saved now, I'll give up everything, the thing that that's most valuable to me. But Paul said, no, I go beyond even that. I'm going to give up everything so I can get the highest thing about Jesus. How many of you want that? If you don't want that, walk out of my class. Just walk out right now. And I mean that. Just walk out. Get up and walk out. Because you are really here because of this. This is, I'm teaching you how I got it and what the Lord showed me, the path he took me down. I don't just want the knowledge of Christ Jesus. I want the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord. If God said that you could have 2,000, or you could have 200, which one would you accept? How are you going to settle for 200 when he said you can have 2,000? That's what excellency is about. You can have a lot of knowledge about Jesus Christ, your Lord. But it's when you want the excellency of that knowledge. And this is why I know deep mysteries about him. I know him personally. I know his heart. And I was talking to somebody today. They figured out one mystery. I was so happy they saw it. But you, when you start to know Jesus as a person, not only that, you start to be like him. But I've always been a person that loved banqueting and feeding people. I've fed people on the street for years, and I love doing that. I'm always finding a way to help people. When I went into the prisons to help people and fed prisoners and just did all kind of things. Like I used to start out doing that. But when you learn Jesus, he's the same way. And they caught it. They said, I noticed this is how Jesus is. He loved to feed people. He fed the 5,000. He turned fish into 5 loaves of bread. He cooked a meal for the disciples on the beach. He did the Last Supper. Christ is someone who loves to eat and he loves to feed people. He loves to have banquets. Anyway, we won't talk about that. We won't talk about the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus our Lord, because all you want is Daniel in the lion's den, right? You want a message like that? Huh? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And I love those boys. I love those teenagers, how they stood up for God. You know what I'm saying? But what do y'all want? Y'all want Jesus wept prayer? Are you ready to go? You know, what are you here to learn? What do you really want? Because what I have is not shallow. What I have attained the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord. I know him personally. Just like some people like head rubs, some people like foot rubs. Where you think we get that from? We're made in likeness and image of God. When you start to learn that, Jesus start to tell you, I like the foot rub. Christ loved his feet with oil poured on it. You wouldn't know those personal things about him if you're not around him. If you don't learn the excellency of him as a person, I'm talking about just a person. It'll always be religion to you. It'll always be, you know, oh, it's Easter again. It's Palm Sunday. Oh, we're celebrating Jesus, and that's wonderful. But it's all superficial, and it's no depth to really knowing this person who did all of this for you. And this is what happened to me. I fell in love with him because I simply sat by the radio and listened to a song that unlocked my heart toward him. That's what you got to do. And I'm going to teach you how to do that today. We're going to do it today. That's what this time is about. Oh, y'all praise God on that. Y'all getting that, aren't you? But you want to know, you know how people, they struggle with giving up stuff for God? I'm going to tell you the easy, simple process where you can give up stuff. If you fall in love, you'll give it up easy. You see, I fell in love. So when the Lord told me give up everything, I wasn't thinking about, oh, how I'm going to eat, how I'm going to get any money. I didn't care about no money. I was just happy that he gave me a command to do something. You know what I'm saying? And this is my opportunity to show him that I can obey him and I can love him like this. That's how it was for me. That was my focus. It wasn't, oh, let me think about what I got to give up. Oh, if I do this, then this will happen. I wasn't even thinking like that. So that's what I'm talking about. By the time Christ started telling me I look back then for a teenager, those were hard decisions. And my parents and my family and my friends, they were all saying, are you sure? So anytime years would pass by, and when I had to give up my private jets and limousines and my skyscraper and my mansion, I mean, not mansion at that time, but a nice home on the lake. It's a $500,000 mansion. The first one I ever built. When the Lord sent an angel to me to do those things, it was nothing. When bishops were saying, you know, it's going to take you 20 years to get this back. They said, we don't even have as much as you have those things. And what we do have, it took us 20 years. It basically took me 13, 12 years to get it. And they were like, well, it's going to take you another 20 years or that amount of years to get it. I'm like, I don't care. I said, did you hear what I said? God sent an angel to me in a dream and asked me, was I willing to do this? And I am. I was just happy he asked me. Because when you're in love, it's like anesthesia. You don't feel the pain. You don't feel the pain. You just do it because you're so focused on that person. And I know this generation don't know hardly or nothing about what it means to be in love with anybody, because they're so superficial with their love. They ain't real, and they are not truly invested. They do not know how to be in love. They really don't. They're too selfish to be in love, and they're too invested in themselves and in their selfishness and other stuff to really have that real, true heart. I think this generation, we got to have a whole deliverance session on how to get delivered from not even knowing how to love, but we even go anywhere. He said, yes, doubtless, I count all things. How many things? All things, not just the things that matter to me. He says, you know what? I'm going to give up everything. Everything. That I may win the highest level of knowledge that is in Jesus about this person. Not just about him, but I want him. Now watch this. Then he go further. For whom, watch this, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things. He lost it all for you. He gave up his life for you. He lost it all for you. When are you going to lose it all for him? That's my problem with Christians today. They celebrate this time of everything he gave up to win them. But when are you going to give up everything to win him? This is what Paul was saying. The paradigms are changing. The winds are shifting. You shouldn't be at the same place in your walk with God that you were 3 years ago, 2 years ago, 1 year ago. Your heart should be surrendering to him continually. This is what makes me mad with Christians, because they celebrate this time and they give up nothing for him. They're not losing nothing. They're not suffering nothing. And Paul is saying, and this is what I was doing. I patterned myself after his words. I started doing this at 17 years old. This scripture meant everything to me. Philippians 3 at 17 years old. And I kept meditating day in, day out, every day for years on this. And when God told me to give up something, I was ready, because this was in my heart. But they ain't doing this. They ain't suffering nothing. So when I was patterning after him, I was willing to suffer the loss of anything. A jet, a skyscraper, money, things, a relationship. It didn't matter to me. And so in 1983, by the time I get around 1983, God gives me a dream and says, you already have the power that Peter and Paul them had. How did I get the power that Paul had? Because I studied his words and I did what he did. Oh, how did I become God's friend? Because I studied and watched what Abraham did, and I did what he did. You can't have what these people have if you ain't willing to do what they did. He gave it all up for you. He lost his life for you. When are you going to give it all up for him? And I ain't just talking about, well, I came to GMMI. That ain't enough. In your heart, there's still stuff you are holding on to. You will not give up, and you have not given it up for him. Paul was like, I ain't wasting no more time. I'm giving up everything. And that's how I got everything. The right-hand seat, all this stuff, very early. Because I did what it takes adults to do a whole lifetime. I did it when I was young. So next thing I know, you got the right-hand seat. You're emperor. God can trust you with the keys of the kingdom. Christ is coming to me, telling me all these things, taking me to heaven, or coming to me in my dreams on earth, or sending angels to me. And I didn't know how I got it, but this is how I got it. I simply fell in love, which caused me to give up and want to give up anything and lose everything for him. So now you understand, when they persecute me and I look bad out there, I don't give a darn. It ain't just no words for me. Oh, Apostle Taylor might be somewhere crying and hurt over.
I don't care. Don't cry for me. I don't get hurt over that junk. You need to understand, I'm always comparing what he suffered on that cross for me whenever I have to give up or suffer anything. I'm like, what is this compared to what he did for me? I mean, these suckers on YouTube and all this want to talk about me. I'm like, what is that? He got the people in this generation, we're so sorry for you. I'm like, what are you sorry for me for? They have not even whipped me. I have not gotten touched one time. No blood. That's what the Bible said. You have not suffered unto blood, striving against sin. I've shed no blood yet. Like, what is that? That matters to you because you're caught up in the age of this generation. You're not caught up in the ancient way, in the ancient path. The ancient path is the path Jesus walked down, not the path. Oh, this new 21st century path. Oh, if you suffer social media persecution. Oh, that's great. That's 21st century modern persecution. It's nothing. It's nothing compared to what he went through. So when I start, that's why it says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith, who for the joy that was set before him, suffered on the cross. It says, look unto Jesus. It says, for consider him who suffered such persecution against his enemies, lest you be weary and faint in your mind. You want to know why I ain't weary? A lot of people say, how are you still going and all this stuff you've been through? I ain't weary and I don't faint in my mind because Jesus is my freaking example. He is the one I look at. When you pattern after anything else, you are weak. You become weak. The Bible says you are to look at him, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy to be able to sit at the right hand of God that was set before him. That was the joy. You want to know the joy set before me? That I'm going to sit at the right hand of Jesus. And now that I'll be able to sit in his throne with him. Not that he's going to give me the throne. That's his throne. I just like the fact that he's offering me to be with him that close. Because to sit with someone in their throne, you got to either go inside their body or sit on their lap. And I don't think this means sitting on his lap in Revelation 3. I know what it is because Jesus, I like Jesse Duplantis' visitation when he saw Jesus and the Father interacting. He saw such love between both of them. They were both in love with each other. And he just said how they would walk in and out of each other, how Jesus would walk into that light with the Father and be lost. And then he'll walk out of that light again. How beautiful is that? And he's offered us that we be one with them, even as him and the Father is one. I and them and they and me. I saw this in heaven when he walked inside my body and I walked in back inside of his body when we minister on the stage together to the people in my crusades. That's what he told me what happens, that he comes to all of my crusades physically and walk in and out of my body, and he walk out of my body into the audience. How did I get out of that? By the time I didn't have no gray beard down to my ankles to look like an Abraham that was God's friend. I didn't have to be that old to get it because I was willing to do what they did. Why? Because love puts you on a fast track for things that take other people years to get. So if you don't choose love, if you choose faith, or if you choose hope or any of those other routes, those are lesser paths and expressways. The quickest expressway is the love expressway. And love makes you do this. Listen what Paul said, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and do count them but what? Dung. That means poop. He treats everything else like poop. Dog mess. That's what it gotta mean to you. See, love will reduce. When there's a comparison of your love for Christ and something else you got to give up, you ain't up here struggling, God, it's hard for me to get it up. It's hard. Because you know what? You value it too much. It ain't nothing but dog poop. That's the way it should look to you. Cow mess. Because if it don't, let me tell you one thing. If you struggle in anything to give up anything for Christ, and it's a competition, the devil has already pooped on you. You know, they say that evil curse word in the world. He's already pooped on you. Yeah. So what I've learned, if you treat God like that, and you let the devil mess on you, and you mess over Christ, then that means you willing to mess on Jesus. That's why a lot of you crap on Jesus all the time. You crap on him all the time because you don't count the stuff you value as nothing, as crap itself. Do you understand what I'm saying? Now we got to make it plain, because this Paul said that everything you value or everything that you must give up got to become like cow mess. And you know how mess smell. Y'all know we've had these animals around here, these cats and dogs, and you know when they poop sometimes, man, I'm serious, this stuff smell up the room. I'm like, I can't take it, P.O.P. We'll get the guys on the front row to clean it all up. that's wrong. That's evil of me. That is so wrong. That's so wrong. You know what? I'm sorry. Sometimes it comes out. I'm, yeah. yeah, just. Y'all understand what I'm saying? How long have you been crapping on Jesus? Because the thing is, if you don't treat the stuff you value like crap, you're going to treat Jesus like crap. And you're going to crap on this opportunity for all of eternity. Do you understand that? You only get one lifetime to do this, to prove yourself, to be anything for eternity. Are you willing to give that up for this bunch of crap down here? Because some of you are, and that's the way you live. That's the way your mentality is. And I detest that, because I love him so much, I hate to see people mistreat him. And I see Christians do it all the time. You don't really care about him. Out of sight, out of mind. Because he ain't in your sight, out of mind. But I love how David said he had a face-to-face relationship with God. He says, I have kept you before my face continually. Hallelujah. Thou art always before my face, oh God. I don't care if Jesus ain't appearing to me. I keep him before my face. I keep his visitation. I see his image continually before my face. That's part of face to face. Paul had face to face. He mentions it in 1 Corinthians 13. I have suffered the loss of all things and do count them but dung. Now watch this. Now he goes to the next level. The first then he says, I count them lost for Christ. That means that I may win salvation. The things that are gained to me. Like that test the young rich ruler went out and he failed. And Jesus says, how hardly shall those who trust in riches enter the kingdom of heaven? He lost his salvation. And a lot of you are going to lose your salvation over the thing you value the most because you ain't willing to give that up for Jesus. That's the first level. Second level, he says, I've given up everything. Peter came to Jesus and said, well, we have given up everything for you. What shall we have? Then when you give up the everything, Christ says, okay, now you can start winning the highest level of knowledge about who I am by experience. You can have that with me.
And then the third level is to suffer the loss of all things. So the first level is you count these things lost for Christ, and you count all things. It's a counting. You get what I'm saying? It's like you've passed the test in your mind and in your soul. But then he says, whom I have suffered the loss of all things. So here it is. It's one thing for it not to matter to you and you count it as nothing. It's another thing for you to suffer the loss of all things. That means after you've lost it, now you know what it feels like to suffer from losing those things that were valuable. Do that make sense? This is the third dimension. And then he says, this is when you win Jesus. You'll win Jesus. You won't get just excellency of the knowledge about who he is. You start to win him personally, on a personal level. He will be your friend. He will be everything. He will be close to you. There will be a relationship by experience. You will win him. That's what I wanted. When he first appeared to me at 17, I wanted to know who he was. But I wanted to win him. When I started reading that Paul was saying you could win Jesus, that he is the prize of this whole life, of why you here, you exist here on earth. Jesus is the prize. He is who you must win, not just knowledge about him, not just win eternal life. And listen to what else will happen to you if you get the third level. And be found in him, not having my own righteousness. That's what's wrong with a lot of you. That's why some of you are judgmental. You're always judging stuff in your mind and all that junk. You haven't hit this level, because when you hit that level, that judgmental spirit will leave your life. Because it says this, be found in him, not having my own righteousness. This process cleans you out. People who have their own righteousness are prideful, and that pride leads them to be judgmental. All judgmentalness is the root of judgmentalness is a self-righteous spirit. That's what it is. Write that down, because you need to know that. Next time you judge your brother or sister, just know you're operating in a pride that is making you self-righteous. Watch this. And be found in him, not having my own righteousness. Watch what he says, which is of the law. What law? The word of God. So this self-righteousness is steeped in a deeper foundation of you even knowing the word or the law of God. That's what makes you judge. How would you really be judgmental? How else would you ever be like that if you didn't know the law of God or the law of righteousness? The law of God's word. That's what makes you like that, because you think you're right because you know what's right. But just because you know what's right don't mean you are right. It can mean you are self-righteous. All of the self-righteousness come from the law. That means right and wrong of the things that you know that God has taught. So to give you a good example of this, when they caught that woman in the act of adultery, the law of God says she's wrong. They were judging her from the law. That was self-righteousness. But look at how Jesus dealt with her, with mercy. That's how you know you are not operating in self-righteousness. It says, and that which is through, I'm sorry, and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness of God by faith, which Abraham walked in. Next thing you'll get, 10, that I may know him. There it is, that I may know him personally. When you win Christ, you get all of this. If you win him, you get all of this. That I may know him. That's enough. And the power of his resurrection. You will know resurrection power.
That's why the power of raising the dead is strong on me. And I also understand resurrection power. I started to understand resurrection power when I came, when I won Jesus. I started to know him and the fellowship of his sufferings being made conformable unto his death. I started understanding his sufferings and watching the types and patterns of how his sufferings played out in my life. I was a fellowship with those sufferings in a certain way. 11. If by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead, not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which I am apprehended, which also I am apprehended of Christ. So you need to understand, he's saying I'm not perfect, but I have not attained everything. But he says, these things have I attained. These things I'm going after. And this is the price. Listen to this. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do. He says, I don't think I'm perfect and I haven't attained to the everything I need to. He said, but one thing I have learned is I know how to forget those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before. That what has helped me. I would read this every day. I would forget about the last things that happened in my life, the last few seconds, and I was looking forward to the future and reaching forth to attain Jesus. You got to have this kind of mind in you to put everything in the past behind you and reach forth to what's in front of you, that you still, because you can't get so depressed that you get down and you stop looking forward and reaching forward. That spirit of depression is of the devil. It keeps you stuck and paralyzed in the past where you can't reach forth to the future of what God has for you or what you can have in God. I don't care if you failed the last 5 minutes. Forget about it. Keep moving forward and focus on what's in front of you and get better. He said, it's one thing I have learned to do. I know how to forget stuff behind. He said, I ain't like Lot's wife. Jesus said, remember Lot's wife. The New Testament warns us about being like her, looking back. That's how you turn into a pillar of salt, because you keep looking back. Your past has a stronghold on you. Looking forth unto those things which are before. That's the future. Looking to the future. Looking to what God has in the future for you. I wake up every day with happiness and expectation. You want to know why? You want to know why a lot of people are depressed? Because they keep looking back in the past or where they are and where they're stuck at and what's going on in their life now. I'm always waking up looking to the future. Oh, God, what do you have planned? I what do you got planned in the future? What, my mind is fixed like this. And yours should be too, because the word of God says in Philippians 3 that it should. Reach forth unto those things which are before. Now listen, to Paul goes further. 14, I press toward the mark for the prize. Who's the prize? Jesus Christ. Of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. What is the high calling of God in Christ Jesus? The right hand having Christ, winning Jesus. That's the highest call. It's just Jesus. Finding him and winning him in a special way. I press toward the mark for the prize. Of the high calling of God in who? Christ Jesus. Let us therefore, as many as be perfect. If you want to mature and become perfect, it says be thus minded. This is the way you're supposed to think. And if in anything you be otherwise minded, God shall reveal even this unto you. God will start telling you this is the way you need to think. Forget about the past. Keep reaching forth to the future. Look toward the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. It's in Christ Jesus. The high calling of God is in Christ Jesus. It's not in the Holy Spirit. It's not in nothing else. It's in Christ Jesus. That's why this time means everything. What, according to his passion that he wrought on the cross, you must understand that the high calling of God in your life is in Jesus. Paul said he's the prize.
And then in the other few verses, he says, you must win him. You only win a prize. He said that I may win Christ. He used the word W-I-N in verse 8. He used the word win Christ. You only win prizes. So what he said, I press toward the mark of the prize. Then what is the prize? He told you what it was in verse 8. Winning Christ. That's what it says. I press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Who is the high calling of God? What is the high calling of God? It's in Christ Jesus. It's winning Jesus. It's winning Christ on a special level. When I read this and understood this when I was a teenager, I said, I got to have you. I want to win you. You are the prize. I want you, Jesus. I want to know who you are. I want to learn you. And that's when the visitations did not stop. At 17, they kept going. Because he is who I wanted. And on Easter and on Palm Sunday, this was the whole reason why he came to die for you. It says, he that covereth the transgression seeketh love. The reason why Christ came on that cross to die for your sins and came to this earth to love you and cover all your transgressions by his blood is because he is seeking your love. You're supposed to be falling in love with him. He's supposed to mean everything to you. He's supposed to mean everything to you. He's supposed to mean everything to you. You are supposed to be falling in love because that's what he wants from you. That's why he died. That's why he covers your transgressions. Because he's seeking your love. And those who give it to him will win him. Put on the song, We Thank You. And let's think on him. Let's love him with our mind. He says, love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, mind, and strength. Your mind has to love him. I taught my mind to love him when I was sitting in front of that radio for hours and think on him. David said, I meditate on thee in the night watches. When do you ever meditate just on him as a person? How good he is. How loving he is. When do you ever do that? When do you train your mind to think on Jesus? Play the song. For your grace and mercy. We thank you thankful for salvation. Salvation means the cross, the suffering of Jesus to me. We praise your name, for you are worthy. You brought us through trial. They sing this song with reverence for Jesus. That's why it's so anointed. It's reverent about what he did on the cross. Come on, think about it. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. We pray you. We praise you. We think about how he suffered for you, how he was whipped and he bled in his back for you. We praise you.
You reached out one day and you made me whole. Thank you, Lord. He gave me a brand new reason for living. We ought to thank you for hanging from the sixth to the ninth hour. Thank you, Lord. Oh, he gave his life as a ransom for you and I. Yes, he did. And just for this, we ought to say hallelujah. We ought to say hallelujah. You ought to give him the praise, the glory, and all the honor that you can give him today. Thank you, Lord.
How amazing. How amazing. Let's play it again. Think on him. Think on him again. His kindness on the cross.
salvation, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Pick up the line.
We praise you.
So
for you.
Brought us through so many trials, tribulations, got us out of snares, dangers and perils. You rescued us from dangers and perils. You gotta really thank him and have gratitude in your heart.
Why now, Jesus?
We praise you for
your worthy.
Worthy. You brought us through tribulation. You reached down and rescued us from dangers, perils, and snares of the enemy. Supposed to be destroyed. We're so thankful for you. We're so thankful for you. We're so thankful for you. We're so thankful for you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for rescuing us when the enemy wanted to destroy us. When we did things we were supposed to be destroyed for, you rescued us. Your blood. We thank you. I'll always thank you. Always thank you, Lord. Always thank you. We always thank you. You're worthy. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for the mercies. Thank you for the blood of atonement on the mercy seat. Thank you for saving my soul. Thank you for saving my soul, God. Thank you for saving my soul. Come on, you gotta use your mind to love him. Gotta rebuke the devil out of your mind to get into this place of loving him with your mind and thinking on his goodness and what he has done for you.
We ought to thank him for hanging from the 6th to the 9th hour.
We pray.
And just for this, we ought to say hallelujah. we ought to say hallelujah. You ought to give him the praise, the glory, and all the honor that you can give him today. Thank you, Lord. We ought to praise your name,
Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Put the anthem on. He did it for us. Death could not hold you down. You are the risen King. Yeah. Seated in majesty. You are the risen. Risen King. We sing. Hallelujah. You have won it. You have won the victory. And we thank you. You overcame for us, Lord. Hallelujah. You have won it all for me. He won it for you. Hold you down. So I love this song. It says you want it all for me. He want it all for you. Come on. Thank him. Seated in majesty. Ruler is our King. Hallelujah. You have won. It all for you. He did it for you. Come on, make it personal. He did it for you. You down. You are the risen King. Seated. Majesty. You are the risen King. His blood. Yes, Lord. We say hallelujah to you. We say thank you to you. You did it all for me. You died for me. You rose from the dead for me. Come on, lift your hands and make it personal. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. You did it for us. You did it for us. You did it all for us. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. You have won the victory. You won it for us. You have won it all for me. Death couldn't hold you down. You did it for me. You didn't let death hold you down for me. I'll give you everything. I'll give you everything. I'll give you everything.
I'll sing it again. Hallelujah.
I'll give you everything. I'll give you everything. You have won the victory. You want it all for me. Make it personal. It was done for us. Done for you. You done. You didn't let death hold you down. You didn't give no excuses to win me. I will give no excuses to win you. Seated in majesty, you are the risen. You're the risen King, victorious in power. Hallelujah! You have won the victory. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, for me. Death could not hold you. You didn't let death stop you. We will not let death stop us. Risen King. See this in majesty. You are the risen. I'll give it all to you. I'll give it up to you.
Hallowed be your name.
I'll give it up to you. I'll give it all to you. I surrender afresh. Yes, Lord, your name is above all names. And above all names. Hallelujah. You have won the victory. Jesus, death could not hold you down. Death could not hold you down. We won't let nothing hold us down. Yeah. Seated in majesty, you are the risen King. We submit to your excellence. Submit to you. Submit to your love, Lord. Thank you. Thank you for winning the victory. Wash us in your blood. Forgive us of our sins. Forgive us of our offenses to you. Forgive us if we've grieved you or hurt you in any way. Forgive us. Wash us in your blood. Wash us. Cleanse us. Clean our hearts. Create in us a clean heart. Renew the right spirit in us. Cast us not away from your presence. Take not your Holy Spirit from us. We don't just want to be forgiven. We also want to be changed, converted. Transform us, Lord. Hallelujah. You have won the victory. Hallelujah. You have won it all for me. Death and I hold you down. You are the risen King, seated in majesty. You are the risen King. Hallelujah. It's something about worship and songs that unlock your mind and your heart. And it also, it channels your mind. It brings government to your mind to think about a certain narrative concerning Jesus. This is why you need music. Music helps. It breaks strongholds, especially if it's anointed. That's why you need it in your prayer time. Yeah, now we're going to play the right version of the anthem. That one was wonderful. But he talks about, by your blood, we are cleansed, by your nail. I want to hear those words because those words helped you to understand what Christ did on the cross. Go ahead. Yeah.
By his nails, his hands
we're free. Yes.
By his blood.
By his blood.
We are
washed clean.
Now we have the victory.
Yeah.
The power of the
Jesus
overcame it all.
The power of sin is broken. Sin don't have to have dominion over your life. Jesus overcame it. He has won our freedom. Jesus has won it all. That's enough to thank him about. And shout, hallelujah. You have won the victory. Thank you for what you did. You're so loving. We're so thankful for you. De lo moshele manika, refe la bosi. Wash us, Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, you're welcome. Hold you down.
You are the risen King. Seated in majesty. You are the risen King.
Here it is again. Listen. We are healed by his nails. We're free. By his blood, we're washed clean. We got the victory. He's given us the victory through his blood. The power of sin is broken. It's broke. Jesus overcame it all. He's given us the power to overcome. The power of sin. He has brought our feet freedom. Jesus has won it all. He paid for our freedom. He paid for our freedom. Hallelujah.
You have won the victory. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
You have won it all for me.
Death could not.
Oh, you are risen King. Seated in majesty. You are the risen King.
Yes,
he won the victory. His rule is on high.
I've got his reason.
Yes, he's risen.
He won the victory. His rule is on high.
I've got his
reason. It's on high. He won the victory.
He won the victory. Thank you, Jesus. Our God is risen. He is alive.
Won the victory. Is on high. Hallelujah.
You've won the victory, Lord. You did it for me.
Oh, you died.
You didn't let death hold you down. We won't let death hold us down. We won't let sin hold us down, oh God. We owe you our love back. The way you gave it to us.
You have won the victory. Hallelujah. You have won it all for me. Death could not hold you down. You are the risen King, seated in majesty. You are the risen King.
Spiritual realities. Hallelujah. Spiritual realities. Make spiritual realities. Make spiritual realities. manifested in our life. Jesus. Oh, Jesus. 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 Our great King. Yes. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We focus on dwelling place. Turn it up loud.
Are your dwelling places thirsty?
I'm thirsty.
I come
after you.
You.
We come after you right now. We come after you, Jesus.
Jesus,
my joy and my prize, my reward. Your love is restoring.
Your love's restoring my soul. Now I'm yours and you are
I want to be yours and you are mine. Oh God, Jesus.
My heart
and soul will
rise. I love
There is none beside you.
There is none
beside you. You're the righteous ruler and emperor of the earth. Ruler of
the earth.
You're the emperor. Nations shall come and bow down.
Nations will come.
They have to bow to you. They have to bow to you. Nations, your name is above. It's over all names.
Praises.
Say to you is I love you, I love you. Ooh, Jesus.
I love you.
Oh Jesus, I love you, I love you, I love you, and my heart will follow wholly after.
I love you.
I love you, love you, I love you, and my heart will follow only after you. My heart is holy.
I love you.
of you, and my heart will follow wholly after you.
Only follow.
Do it again. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. We love your dwelling places. We want to be in your holy place. Thirsty, I come after you, Lord. So thirsty for you.
Jesus, my joy,
my reward. My heart will follow only you.
I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you.
My strongest weakness is you. The next one. Thank you, Jesus. Our heart will fold out. Turn it up. Don't be turning it down. Jesus, you placed your arms around me. And I grew in your grace.
And I grew in your grace.
And you're the reason why.
And you're the reason why.
There's a smile on my face.
There's a smile upon my face.
You came along.
And you came along.
And made my life
and
new. Cause my strongest weakness
is you.
Always declare that Jesus is your strongest weakness, not anything else. What you see in me, the world could never know. It's between you and I. It has to be personal.
In love will always grow.
In love, our relationship covenant will always
Heaven
grow.
Heaven has smiled on me.
Heaven has smiled on me.
In the form of your love.
It burns my soul.
Burns my soul like fire. There's no greater love.
There's no greater love than this.
You're everything I touch.
You're everything I do.
You're everything I do.
Cause my strongest weakness is you.
Before we met, I never loved so much. No. You show me how with just
a single touch. Do it because of you.
What you see in me.
What you see in me, the world will never know.
The world may never know. Between you and I, in love
will always grow.
Heaven has smiled on me in the form of love.
Decree it.
He's your strongest weakness.
Don't leave my life brand new.
Not your weakness is your strongest weakness. He is your strongest weakness.
Everything I touch,
everything I do.
That's why everything I do, I do it because of you. Weakness is you, is you.
Hallelujah. Let's sing that again. Let's think on it. Always decree it for the rest of your life that He is your strongest weakness.
Yeah.
Yes. Let's put the next one on. Yes, by Mississippi Mass Choir. Let's think on him. Yes.
My soul.
Your soul has to say yes. I want to be for you.
I want to be in every day, in every way. I want to say,
I want to say, I say yes. I surrender. I say yes.
My soul says yes to your will, Lord.
Come on, lift your hands and sing it.
Yes.
Say it.
Yes. Wherever you want me to go, it's yes.
Wherever you want me to go, it's yes.
Whatever you want me to do, it's still yes.
Whatever you want me to do, it's yes.
My soul. Give
you everything.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. My soul
says yes.
If you want me to sing, I say yes. If you want me to pray, I say yes.
If you want me to pray, I'll say yes. Yes, Lord. My soul says yes.
if you don't know. But I'm not ashamed anymore to let the Lord know that I know him as a healer. He's not my doctor, he's my healer. You see, when we were here back in 1988, I did near the cross, not knowing that the enemy was going to try me and see if he could steal my rest. I went in the hospital. I stayed in there 6 months. I was perplexed, couldn't think straight. Some of you don't know what it's like to be out of your right mind. I was crawling the walls, running when nobody was chasing me. But you know, I was in that room, they had me locked up. And if I couldn't do nothing else, you see, I went down.
Your soul gotta say yes to him. Oh, when you feel his love, your soul will say yes. Your soul will say yes. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, let your soul say yes.
Can you lift your hands and say yes?
Surrender to
him. Say yes, my soul.
My soul.
Everybody say it. Say yes. Come on. Lift your voices and say yes. Thank you, Jesus. Come on. Say yes. Come on.
Let's play it again. That needs to get into our spirit. God, yes. Tell God, yes. Surrender to him. Surrender your heart and your life to him. want to be all that you want me to be, Lord. If you want that, lift your hands and tell him, I want to be all that you want me to be.
I surrender
my everything. That's right, tell him.
I surrender my
all
to thee. A living testimony.
A living testimony. I want to be in every way, every day. Come on, say it. Yes.
My soul says, yes. Yes to your will, Lord.
Yes.
Yes, Lord.
That's right. You got to listen to songs like this until your soul breaks. To everything in you, surrender.
Wherever you want me to go, it's yes.
Wherever you want me to go, it's yes. Whatever you want me to do is still yes. My soul, I surrender.
My soul says yes.
Yeah.
My soul says yes. Lord, I give you everything, yes. Yes, Lord,
I give you everything.
Yes, Lord. My soul,
I give you everything, Lord.
Yes.
I give you everything. I give you everything. Say yeah. I give you everything. I give you everything, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Jesus, you're the Son of God. The next one.
The city streets and the sidewalks.
Het is op de straten, de stoep.
The city streets and the sidewalks.
They suddenly grew still.
As a man,
thank you, Jesus,
came through the entrance of the city.
He touched and healed a blind man
with a little piece of clay. And as he would turn, you would hear the people say, they said, Jesus,
Jesus, you is the Son of God. Jesus, Jesus, the precious Son of God, the sweetest rose of Sharon, he came to set us free. Jesus, is everything to me, is all of the world to me.
There are footprints in the sand,
the shores of
God. Think
Ladies
about
and gentlemen,
it.
They're the footprints of the thousands who
they
came
to
see
him. Think about
he
Jesus.
Spoke of love and kindness.
Think about
Dear
Jesus.
Brother, he brought a man and as he would turn, you'd hear those little simple people
say, his name is Jesus. Jesus, he is the Son of God. Jesus, Jesus, the precious Son. Jesus, he's everything to me, he's the whole world to me.
Is he the whole world to you? As they nailed him to the tree,
yeah.
And there he died for every man and woman from every nation. But the words he spoke,
yes,
and the price he paid, it's changing lives
today.
And with joy and praise, you can hear every person in this arena rejoice.
Joseph
sing his name.
His name is Jesus. Sing his name, saints. You is the Son of God. Sing his name. Jesus, the precious Son of God, the sweetest rose of Sharon,
he came to set us free.
Your name is Jesus. Jesus, you're everything to me. You're the whole world to me. Play that again. Yes,
the straten, the stoep.
Thank you.
The city streets and the sidewalks.
They suddenly grew still.
You're the whole world to me.
As a man,
everything to
came
me.
Through the entrance of the city.
He touched and healed a blind man.
With a little piece
of clay.
And as he would turn, you would hear the people say.
Jesus,
He is the Son of God.
His name is Jesus.
Jesus.
Sing His name.
Jesus,
the precious Son of God.
The sweetest rose of Sharon.
You came to set us free.
Jesus
is everything to me.
You're all the world to me.
You're all the world to me.
In the sand,
you're all the world.
Along the shores of Galilee, ladies and gentlemen, they're the footprints of the thousands.
You're all the world to me. Lord.
Who came to see Him?
He spoke of love and kindness.
Oh, my dear brother, He brought a bed of wind. And as He would turn, you'd hear those little simple people say,
Jesus,
He is the Son of God.
Jesus,
the precious Son of God, He's the sweetest rose of Sharon. He came to set us free. Jesus, He's everything to me. The whole world to me.
You're the whole world.
As they nailed Him to the tree,
and there He died for every man and woman from every nation. But the words He spoke and the price He paid, it's changing lives
today.
And with joy and praise, you can hear every person in this arena rejoice and
sing His name.
His name is Jesus.
He is the Son of God.
Jesus,
the precious Son of God.
The sweetest rose of Sharon.
He came to set us free.
Name is Jesus.
Jesus
is everything to me.
He's all the world to me.
Hallelujah. That is so beautiful. His name is Jesus. Jesus, He is the Son of God. Jesus, the precious Son of God. The sweetest rose of Sharon, You came that I might be free. Jesus, You are everything to me. You're all the world to me. Jesus, You are the Son of God. Jesus, the precious Son of God, the sweetest rose of Sharon, You came that I might be free. Jesus, You're everything to me. You're all the world to me.
Hallelujah. Come on, let's give Him praise. Sing His name and give Him praise. Thank You, Jesus. You're everything to us, Lord. You're everything to us. You're everything.
You are the world. You're all the world to us. Jesus, Jesus, you are the Son of God. Jesus, Jesus, precious Son of God. The sweetest rose of Sharon came that I might be free. Jesus, Jesus, you're everything to me. You're all the world to me. Do we mean everything to you, Saint? Do we mean everything to you? He has to mean everything to you. Absolutely everything. Jesus, you are the Son of God. He is the Son. Jesus, Jesus, precious Son of God. The sweetest rose of Sharon came that I might be free. Jesus, Jesus, you're everything to me. You're all the world to me. Thank you. I love the way Benny and Steve Brock sing. That's just so beautiful. When they would sing that in the arenas, when I would go to this massive crusade, it was just so beautiful. The presence of God singing about Jesus. There is a special anointing when you sing his name. There's a special anointing that comes upon you of the Holy Spirit when you sing his name. You have to sing his name. Hallelujah. Songs that sing his name. Hallelujah. Thank you. Jesus, Jesus, precious Son of God, sweetest rose of Sharon, came that I might be free. He came that you might be free. Jesus, Jesus, you're everything to me. You're all the world to me. Okay, I know, because Jesus would love for us to worship his Father. We're moving into throne room songs, and then I'm going to let you go. I enjoyed this time with you, but we were going to move into Jesus loves to honor his Father. Because he loves that, we want to give him that tonight. So we will go to the Fred Hammond song, 24L, Cry Holy.
I was in the Spirit, and in heaven saw a throne.
This is the Father.
And he that sat was to look upon his jasper and sard and stone.
Yes.
And before
Jehovah.
The throne the sea of glass,
creatures
never seen.
The creatures, the 24 elders.
Four and 20
four beasts
sat in rows of blood. Made clean and out of the throne
proceeded
voices, thunder rings and light,
yeah.
And the creatures that surround
these creatures
him,
surround our Father,
not day or night, crying holy, holy. Down their golden crowns, crying holy.
You need to have a trip to heaven to see this. It is a spectacular sight.
Worthy be, almighty.
to see your Father sit on the throne. The four-piece worship.
Forever.
If they cry holy day and night. You're holy, holy. Casting down the golden crowns, crying out. You need to go to heaven and see this. Jehovah. Your hands and ask God to give you a trip to the throne.
Forever.
The throne room to see his glory like this. Many of you have never seen his glory. These songs, you can't possibly understand the depth of them until you go to heaven and see Jehovah.
Forever and forever. And forever.
Worship you because of Jesus has reconciled the relationship by his blood. You're Alpha and Omega. You're forever and ever. Play that one more time. It's throne room worship. Play it again.
I was in the spirit, and in heaven saw a throne.
Heaven saw a throne.
And
he that sat upon it, like a jasper stone. That's our Father, made out of stones.
Before
the throne, there was a sea of glass. Creatures, the four beasts,
clad in robes, the blood
made clean,
and out of the throne proceeded,
voices, thunderings, and lightnings.
The creatures that surround,
they don't rest day or night. They cry holy. A smoke, clouds of mist going up at the same time, surrounding his throne. Fire, lightning, thunders,
casting down their golden crowns,
crying holy. They're casting down their crowns.
Holy,
holy, you're the Almighty One. Lord, I pray that this staff, that they have trips to heaven at your throne. Let them behold your glory in the third heavens at the throne room. Take them up and ascend them, so they have experiences with you. So they have a chance to cast down their kingly crowns before you, great emperor. Yeah, which was, which is, and is to come.
You
is so powerful and holy. So powerful and holy.
And forever.
So powerful and holy.
And forever.
You are Lord.
You are Lord. Forever.
And forever. Jehovah, great Father, hallowed be thy name, O God. Holy is the Lord, by Dwayne Hunt. The next one, Abundant Life Choir.
See the streets and the sidewalks.
Het is de straten, de stoep.
The city streets and the sidewalks.
They suddenly grew still.
As a man,
thank you, Jesus,
came through the entrance of the city.
He touched and healed a blind man
with a little piece of clay. And as he would turn, he would hear the people say. They said,
Jesus, Jesus, He is the Son of God. Jesus, Jesus, the precious Son of God. Sweetest rose of Sharon, He came to set us free. Jesus,
Jesus,
Jesus.
Sands
along the shores of Galilee,
ladies and gentlemen, they're the footprints of the thousands who came to see Him.
He spoke of love and kindness.
Oh, my dear brother, He brought a better way. And as He would turn, you'd hear those little simple people say,
put your hands and you say, have your arm open.
They said,
Jesus, Jesus, He is the Son of God. Jesus, Jesus, the precious Son.
And there He died for every man and woman from every nation. But the words He spoke and the price He paid, it's changing lives today. And with joy and praise, you can hear every person in this arena rejoice and say,
lift the hand and sing his name.
His name.
Hallelujah. You stop it now. Thank you, Jesus. I just heard the Lord say, the whole $400 million vision shall come to pass. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. It shall come to pass. The whole covenant of the vision. Thank you. Everything he promised shall come back. Thank you. I enjoyed this time with you. Learn how to make this a part of your life. Train your mind to love God. Meditate on him. Not just on the word. You got the Bible talks about loving him with all your mind. This is a practice. There are practices like practicing fasting, practicing the presence of God through spending time in prayer. But then there's something called practicing loving God with your mind. It's when you think on him and you allow songs to navigate your mind through the narration of the right songs that places your mind on God. And not just on God, but I mean specifically Jesus. It says a mind stayed on him, he'll keep you at perfect peace. You will never know what that perfect peace is until you train your mind to stay on him. It says a mind stayed on him, he'll keep you at perfect peace. Train your mind to love God, to meditate on Jesus, to stay on him, and you'll know what perfect peace looks like. Happy Palm Sunday. Y'all take care of love.
The special time has arrived. Passover. And they overcame by the blood of the Lamb.
God has made a provision. God has a plan to overcome.
Celebrate Passover with David E. Taylor. God commands us to come before him and celebrate Christ our Passover.
The focus of Passover is for you to understand the vastness of what his blood not only did for you, what it is doing for you every year. Jesus was not only God's ransom to save our soul as the Lamb of God who redeemed the world through his blood. He also takes that same blood into the heavens and he offers it on the mercy seat. And he becomes our advocate. If it was just all over at the cross, he would never have to sit at the right hand of God to make intercession for us. He still left the devil alive to be your accuser day and night. So he has to sit at God's right hand as an attorney or an advocate for you with the blood to argue your case. The Passover is a time that you reflect on understanding what is going on in the heavens over your life right now. The battles that are being decided, the arguments that are being won, the victory that is being wrought on your behalf. Because if you don't understand this, you go through life carelessly, unthankful. Jesus is your advocate. He is your attorney in the courtroom of heaven to argue against your failures, weaknesses, and sins.
Lift those voices. Be refreshed and renewed at this year's Passover celebration with David E. Taylor.
On April 22nd through the 30th, 2024,
celebrate the commanded first fruit offering that the Lord tells us to bring before him.
There are two times of the year God says you are to consciously
save up money all year round. And when that time, these two times come around, you're supposed to have a special offering that means something to God. That's Passover and Rosh Hashanah. We're going to wave our offerings before God. This is holy.
We are to wave the offering before Him. He says, you're to come before me with a special offering. He says, you and walk before the priest, and they will command the blessing over your life.
Happening online only. Call now, 1-877-THE-GLORY. That's 877-843-4567.
God has destined you to be an overcomer and to help others overcome through the blood of Jesus. It is time for you to become a blood warrior and experience absolute victory over Satan, sin, death, sickness, poverty, and over all the works of the enemy. Your ability to be an overcomer is based on your understanding of the blood and how to activate it in your life. You must have this revelation of the blood to overcome. Don't delay. Become a blood warrior today. Get the two-part series on The Blood Warrior by David E. Taylor. Part 1, Blood Warriors, How to Fight with the Blood of Jesus Against the Enemy. Part 2, The Glory Manifestation of the Blood Warrior. Normally $50, but get both series today, only $20. As well as your free anointed prayer cloths. That's 1-877-843-4567.
JMMI TV with David E. Taylor, bringing you internet television like never before. JMMI TV is now on Roku, touching the nations of the world.
I feel God's power
beginning to flow through this room.
I command every demon of disease. Go! Jesus' name!
Face-to-face miracles today with David E. Taylor.
This is your day for a miracle.
Watch live services.
I feel God's power beginning to flow through this room. Something is happening.
We shall see the world turned upside down.
Choose your subscription plan by choosing the silver, gold, or platinum package, all with different benefits. Call now for more information. 1-877-THE-GLORY, 843-4567.
The Twister churning through the night sky, flattening a candle factory.
Listen, we are trapped.
The deadliest tornado event we have ever had.
What are the biggest needs in this area right now? Water and food.
This is why God has told me to do the convoy of miracles, that when disaster hits, we are there.
When I hit my knees, the wind, I mean, it just tore the roof, and they dug me out. And all I can say is, Jesus is gonna send us some help. You guys have come miles and miles to come down here to show your love.
The Convoy of Miracles, spearheaded by David E. Taylor and his covenant partners, offers a beacon of hope in the face of disaster and the warmth of giving during the holidays. When Hurricane Ian hit, Apostle Taylor sent relief to help many in need. This is just the beginning of the Convoy of Miracles outreach in Florida. 2,000 cars showed up and over 5,000 people came out as cars pulled up, needing genuine help as Hurricane Ian caused significant damage in Daytona Beach, Florida.
Convoy of Miracles, what a blessing that you guys
Thank you, Apostle David Taylor.
I appreciate everything. Thank you so much.
It's a blessing that everybody's come together and doing stuff for helping us.
And when he reach out, an outreach minister, like, he's being helped.
We appreciate everything that y'all doing for us. It's a blessing. Thank you.
Oh, tell him I said thank you.
There are so many homeless people in California. I have never seen so many homeless people on the street, and I want you to help me to finish the 18-wheeler trucks projects.
We are still in need of $2.5 million to fulfill God's vision and build the rest of the convoy of miracle trucks. 10 trucks will be used to bring clothes, food, hygiene products, and supplies to the masses. There will also be 5 special trailers to meet people's needs. The shower trailer will be able to give the people a clean shower from being on the street. The barbershop trailer is where the men will get their haircuts and the women will get their hair done in this salon. The hot food truck will serve nutritious hot meals daily. The medical truck will do free health inspections, providing treatment and medicine for the sick. The office truck will be used to administratively serve those in need and work to find proper housing for each person and family. There is more exciting news. Apostle Taylor is also getting the help of his covenant friends and partners to get AC-17 aircraft. to be able to expand the convoy of miracles overseas to help the precious people of other nations when disaster or famine strikes with food, water, nourishment, medical supplies, and essentials. Partner now with David E. Taylor to bring supplies, comfort, and relief to hurting families all across America. Call now 1-877-THE-GLORY. That's 877-843-4567 and visit our website at koggc.org.